Good morning. Well, everybody made it through the snowstorm okay, I hope. Everyone who's here is anyways. People who aren't here probably didn't. They're probably still stuck. Welcome to Monadnock Congregational Church. We are super thankful to have you here to worship with us today. We're just going to open up with a few announcements before we jump into our worship service. You'll notice that there's not a lot of youth here. That's because they're away on the youth retreat this weekend, enjoying time of fellowship. Just be praying for them as they enjoy their time and for their leaders, Noah and Anna and Hannah, that they would have strength to finish off the weekend. I've done those weekends before, and I always say I don't think I've walked away from one without a head cold in my 10 years of doing it, so pray for them. Just a couple of logistical things. A reminder that there's a lost and found bin in the front foyer. If you're missing something, check there. If it hasn't been taken in a few weeks, we'll generally empty that out and reset. And last call on the two coats that have been hanging in the foyer for several months now. They won't be there next week, whether someone takes them or we do. So just a reminder on that. For our deacons and trustees, you saw the email come out this last week that we're going to be having our leadership community dinner on March 25th. For those of you who do not know, we do a leadership community, so those who serve as deacons and trustees and elders, we try to get together. We're going to try to get together quarterly this year to share in fellowship, teaching, and shared vision as we seek to serve this church well together. And the last one that I have is Hannah Sweeney. She's away on the youth retreat, but she just wanted to let everyone know that all of the youth ministry positions are filled this week. So if you have a kid in junior church or nursery, that will be available for you. All right. I believe that's all I've got for announcements, unless I'm missing anything major. If not, I would invite Mark up now for our call to worship as we prepare to worship the Lord.
Good morning. The call from worship this morning comes from Psalm 86, verses 3 to 7. Be gracious to me, O Lord, for to you do I cry all the day. Gladden the soul of your servant, for to you, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. For you, O Lord, are good and forgiving, abounding in steadfast love to all who call upon you. Give ear, O Lord, to my prayer. Listen to my plea for grace. In the day of my trouble, I call upon you, for you answer me. Let's bow our heads. Father God, we thank you that you're a gracious God, a loving God, a God who deserves all our adoration, all our worship, all our praise. But Lord, we thank you that you are a God who also has mercies and forgiveness for us on a daily basis and grace to make us grow. Lord, let us reflect quietly in our hearts the sins, the transgressions, the things that we've done wrong this very week. And Lord, as we confess our sins and transgressions to you, Lord, you are merciful and forgiving. And Lord, we ask that you come and have your will in our lives. And thank you, Lord, that we can come and worship you today. Amen.
Good morning. I hope you've all had a great week in the Lord. And as Mark was just reading out of Psalms, God is good and forgiving, abounding in steadfast love to all who call upon him. Please stand as we praise his name this morning and begin our service with the wonderful cross.
Condemned. Slain, I am
We've come to the time of our worship service where we respond to the provision and grace of God by giving back. Our giving here helps support our missionaries both at home and abroad. It helps heat this big meeting space that we get to gather in and worship the Lord. So we thank you all for your generosity, and I pray that we would all give as a form of worship unto the Lord. So as the plates are passed, we will worship together. With me in prayer. Heavenly Father, holy, 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 you are perfectly holy. You are Alpha, Omega, beginning and end. You are gracious and merciful, long-suffering. Your love is steadfast. We thank you for who you are, who you have revealed yourself to be to us through your word, through the testimony of your saints. We thank you, Lord, for your provision over us, for your grace in giving us this building that is warm. We thank you for the energy and heart of the trustees to care so well for this place that you've given us. I pray for all of us as we receive what you've given us that we would act as stewards but not owners, that we would live with an open hand to your glory, knowing that these things are not ours but yours, and we are the opportunity to serve you through them. Lord, we thank you for all these things, and Lord, we lift them up to you as well, knowing that you hear us, that you are near to us, that you care for us. And so, Lord, we lift up all those in our lives who are sick. We lift up Danny, and he's still sick, that you bring healing. Father, we lift up those loved ones that are hurting, who are going through any rehab or anything in that nature, that you would enter in, bring healing physically, emotionally, relationally, spiritually. We just pray for those we love that you would open their hearts and minds to you, your truth, and who you are as Savior and King. Lord, we lift up specifically Morgan and Uncle Patrick, that you would reveal yourself to them in a powerful way. Lord, we lift up Galen, who is swimming, and that he would really enjoy his time there, and that he would enjoy the competition, and that he would be able to do it to your glory. We thank you for the energy you give us to participate in sports and the things that we enjoy. We just pray that as we do them, we would do them to your honor and glory. We thank you for who you are, who you have revealed yourself to be, and who we are in light of that. And we lift all these things up in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, I'd invite the kids up for the children's message, if they'd like to come on up. Just me today. Leslie is unfortunately sick, so we'll figure it out. Good morning. Did you all enjoy the snowstorm yesterday?
No.
Did you have to shovel?
Well, actually, maybe.
Sort of.
Because I don't like snow, but I like to nice
day. You like a day off, yeah. I know. It's hard work. It's nice to have a snow day every once in a while. Anybody sledding? Big sledders? Skiers?
Well, I do ski, but we didn't go skiing this season.
No. Yeah, you didn't go skiing this season,
but
yeah. That's awesome. I remember your driveway. I think I've said it before. I used to not be able to get up it after trustee meetings, so I remember it fondly. Yeah, I can imagine. Well, today, as we look, we're going to be talking about who God is revealing himself to be and who he is in our lives. So part of that is who Jesus is and who he has revealed himself to be. So we're going to read a story that comes out of the book of Matthew and Mark and Luke. So all three of the Gospels has it. It's a storm on a lake. Look at that big wave. That's a pretty big wave. Holy moly. All right. It was evening when Jesus and his disciples got into a boat. They began sailing over to the other side of the Sea of Galilee. But suddenly the wind began to blow very hard, and there was a terrible storm on the lake. High waves came up over the sides of the boat. Soon it was getting full of water and beginning to sink. Oh no. But Jesus was asleep at the back of the boat. "Teacher," the disciples shouted at him, "save us. We'll all be drowned." Then Jesus stood up and spoke to the wind and the water. He said, "Be quiet." The wind stopped blowing and the water became very still and quiet. There were no more high waves, so water wasn't coming into the boat anymore. Then Jesus asked his disciples, "Why were you afraid? Why do you have so little faith?" Even though the disciples were Jesus' friends, it was hard for them to understand how Jesus could make the wind and the water obey him. They still didn't know that Jesus was God's son and that he could do anything. They asked each other, "Who is Jesus anyway? How did he do that?" So in this story, we see that Jesus is showing his disciples, he's showing us too, that hey, I'm not just Jesus the carpenter, but I'm also the Son of God. And because of that, I have control over all of nature. So when he spoke to the waves and the storm, they listened, right? It reminds us that Jesus was there in creation, speaking, and it came to be, "Let there be light," and there was light. So Jesus is revealing who he is. And we can get to know him even more and more and more when we open the Bible, when we spend time. Even with people, we see different attributes of each other, and we get to know each other more. It's the same with God, right? So we spend more time with him. We get to know him more. I don't know if he skis, but maybe. I'm sure he'd be really good at it if he did. But so as we go off into our children's times, just be thinking about, okay, let me get to know God more. Because even the disciples, they spent all this time with him. And even after he stilled the waves, they said, "Who is he?" And we get the opportunity to know more about who this God is through his word. So why don't we say a prayer? Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for the opportunity to get to know you more, the God who can still the storm, who can quiet even our hearts in moments of stress and anxiety. And we just thank you that you are the God who is near, who has revealed himself. And we just give you the honor and glory. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Thanks, all.
Our scripture reading today is found in the book of 1 John, chapter 3, beginning with verse 16. 1 John 3, 16. "By this we know love, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brothers. But if anyone has the world's goods and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? Little children, let us not love in word or talk, but in deed or truth. By this we shall know that we are of the truth, and reassure our heart before him. For whenever our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart, and he knows everything. Beloved, if our heart does not condemn us, we have confidence before God, and whatever we ask, we receive from him, because we keep his commandments and do what pleases him. And this is his commandment, that we believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another just as he commanded us. Whoever keeps his commandments and abides in God and God in him, and by this we know that he abides in us by the Spirit whom he has given us. For this is God's word.
Thank you, Charlie. All right. So before we open up the word for a sermon, let's open up in prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you that we can come before you today to worship corporately. We thank you that this is a good thing that you've called us into. Corporate worship, prayer, preaching of your word, that we submit under your lordship. And so as we preach today, I pray that you'd be glorified, that we would all hear the words that you have for us to hear, that you'd soften our hearts to them by your grace and mercy. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, so we're in 1 John today. We're going to kind of be sticking around there quite a bit, so if you are the type that you'd like to follow along in your chair Bibles or your phone or whatever, we're just going to kind of live in 1 John 3, and I'm going to be jumping around a little bit here and there, so if you want to keep an eye on it, go for it. Otherwise, I've got it all here too, so I won't leave you alone. So, C.S. Lewis, the great author and apologist, was part of a very cool group of friends that is called the Inklings. This group grew very close to one another over the years as they met regularly, enjoyed a pint together, and shared what they were writing with one another. Imagine being in a literary club with both C.S. Lewis and J.R.R. Tolkien. That would be incredible. Well, eventually, one of those friends died, Charles Williams. He had become a very close friend of Lewis's. After Charles's death, Lewis shared some thoughts on the nature of relationships, and especially in how they make us whole. He wrote, quote, "In each of my friends, there is something that only some other friend can fully bring out. By myself, I am not large enough to call the whole man into activity. I want other lights than my own to show all his facets. Now that Charles is dead, I shall never again see Tolkien's reaction to a specifically Charles joke. Far from having more of Tolkien, having him to myself, now that Charles is away, I have less of him. In this, friendship exhibits a glorious nearness of resemblance to heaven itself, where the very multitude of the blessed, which no man can number, increases the fruition which each of us has of God." His point is that when we are in community with others, in a deep relationship, we will draw out elements of one another that we would not see otherwise. It is a profound look at the beauty of relationships and reminds us of the deep need each of us has to know others and be known, and how we will not fully know ourselves apart from deep relationships. This doesn't just apply to our human relationships, but ultimately to our relationship with God. Theologian John Calvin contends that without knowledge of self, there is no knowledge of God. Without knowledge of God, there is no knowledge of self. He writes, "We always seem to ourselves just and upright and wise and holy until we are convinced by clear evidence of our injustice, vileness, folly, and impurity. Convinced, however, we are not if we look to ourselves only and not to the Lord also. He brings the only standard by the application of which this conviction can be produced. We cannot fully know who we are until we know God. Having a knowledge and relationship with our Creator leads us unto a better understanding of who we are. And in so knowing, we can then give ourselves to loving God, loving our neighbors, and making disciples as we go." So our focus today, what is this passage of Scripture telling us about who God is? What does that mean for us? And how does that equip us to love more deeply in a holistic relationship with God and the people around us?
Now, admittedly, we're going to be spending most of our time looking at what this passage is revealing about God. There are so many implications within these truths of who God is. And in my humble opinion, we couldn't really ask for a better guide to teach us about the nature of God than the Apostle John, who self-titled himself as the disciple Jesus loved. I love that. Jesus is consistent in his gospel writing and in the letters he wrote. And part of his consistency is his focus. He is passionate about helping us to understand who Jesus Christ is. Now, bear with me as we read how he opens both his gospel account and his letter here. He writes in the Gospel of John, the first chapter, verse 1 through 5, "In the beginning was the Word." Remember that, in the beginning. "And the Word was with God, and the Word was God." The Word here meaning Jesus. "He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through him, and without him was not anything made that was made. In him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." And now in the opening to this letter, 1 John, notice the similarities of what he's saying, okay? He says in the first chapter, first verse, "That which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we looked upon and have touched with our hands, concerning the word of life, the life was made manifest, and we have seen it, and testified to it, and proclaimed to you the eternal life, which was with the Father, and was made manifest to us." John is passionate about making clear to his readers, ourselves included, who Jesus is, who we will always be, and that the eternal relationship between the Father and Son as members of the Trinity is paramount to our understanding of who God is. He draws us into who God is and then points us to who we are as Christians in light of the reality of our relationship with him. In this letter, John is, among other things, making the point that the divine nature is being manifested in us when we are acting like Christ. Back to Lewis's and Calvin's points, we cannot fully know ourselves in isolation, but only truly understand who we are when we understand who God is. And once we are rightly ordered, this reality will shape how we interact with those around us, loving God, loving others, and making disciples. So what is God revealing about himself? The place we'll start is with one of the essential truths of our Christian faith, that we worship a triune God. The Trinity is the teaching that God is one in being and essence, yet three in persons. That there is one God and that he subsists in three persons. Martin Luther summarized it as such: "We believe the divine majesty to be three distinct persons of one true essence." We see this specifically here in 1 John, verses 23a, 24a, and 24b. I'll read them together. "And this is his commandment, that we believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ. Whoever keeps his commandments abides in God. And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit whom he has given us." Belief in the Son who comes from the Father, we are sealed by the presence of the Spirit. The Trinity communing perfectly together as one in our lives. The doctrine of the Trinity is, to be blunt, a divine mystery. There have been many attempts to articulate how exactly God, who is one, is three persons within the Godhead. Just saying that, I feel confused. But as we see in this passage, Scripture repeatedly teaches that God is one and that God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit are equals and united. Though confusing, this is an essential part of our faith. Now, you'll hear me talk about here at MCC three categories of theology: essentials, convictions, and preferences. A preference is, for example, your preferred style of music. It is a preference, and we can still worship together, even if some of us enjoy more classical hymns or some more contemporary songs. It's not, in the scheme of life, it's not a huge deal, and we should treat it as such. Convictions are matters of doctrine that, though we agree that there are different biblically robust ways of thinking through them, they are more defining of how we express our faith in practice. something like the means of baptism. Are you convicted in the believer's baptism or infant baptism? Still several ways to think through it, but your conviction will determine how you practice your faith. Important, but often not something we would need to break fellowship over. This brings us to essentials. Essentials are the aspects of our faith that we cannot compromise on. Things like the doctrine of the Trinity. This is essential because it speaks to the very nature of the God we worship. We may not totally understand it, but we must abide in it, for from this doctrine flows out how we interact with God and with one another. The doctrine of the Trinity is of the utmost importance. Timothy Keller, you hear him quoted here fairly frequently, puts it like this, quote, "The Trinity means that God is, in essence, relational. The gospel writer John describes the Son as living from all eternity in the bosom of the Father, an ancient metaphor for love and intimacy. Later in John's gospel, Jesus, the Son, describes the Spirit as living to glorify him. In turn, the Son glorifies the Father, and the Father the Son. This has been going on for all eternity," end quote. The doctrine of the Trinity teaches that God has been eternally relational. I'll let Taylor continue. He says, "The life of the Trinity is characterized not by self-centeredness, but by mutually self-giving love. When we delight and serve someone else, we enter into a dynamic orbit around him or her. We center on the interests and desires of the other. That creates a dance, particularly if there are three persons, each of whom moves around the other two. So it is, the Bible tells us," end quote. God, in the Trinity, has eternally been glorifying each person within the Trinity, eternally delighting in and eternally being in relationship with. This is a God who created us not to fill a void to fulfill himself, but because he desired to love us. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 4 to 5 says, "Even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him, in love he predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will." You see, before the foundation of the world was set, God planned to create us, to love us, not for us to perfect him in any way, but for him to perfect us to his glory. We do not serve a God like those in ancient Greek mythology that were petty and interacted with humanity for their own selfish pleasure or vengeance. But we serve a God that is whole, and through that wholeness, he has chosen to delight in us, to love us, and to draw us into this eternal relationship. This truth has many implications and ought to affect all that we do. We can rest in the knowledge of a perfectly loving God who chose to love us before we ever loved him, and that God is fully complete in himself, yet desires that we should be with him, not from a place of need, but from a place of fullness. Christina and I love each other. She's my wife. And we loved each other before Leo, our son, was born. We wanted Leo, and we wanted to love him so much, and we delight in him, and our love for him flows out from the deep love for each other. We're able to love Leo, not from a place of deficiency, but from a place of subtle love with each other. Now, this illustration is imperfect, but I hope that it sort of helps us see, perhaps more clearly, the type of love that God is extending to us from the abundance within the Trinity. Now, knowing this about God, his eternal communal nature, his perfect love and dance within the Trinity, and how from that place of abundance he desired us. Can you believe that? Do you believe that? God wants to have a relationship with you. The creator of the universe sees you and is inviting you in. There's a deep sense of rest from this truth, because it does away with any thought of needing to earn or appease God. That has been done through God the Son, and all we must do is believe and submit unto him. The doctrine of the Trinity deserves much more time than we can devote to it today, but it is essential. And it leads to a peace in the eternal nature and love of God. The next thing that God is revealing about himself in this passage is that our God is one of truth and assurance. 1 John 3:20, by this we shall know that we are of the truth and reassure our heart before him. For whenever our heart condemns us, God is greater than our heart and he knows everything. The God of the Bible is truth. And so when we are of the truth, it means that we are abiding in God and his commandments. Jesus proclaimed, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. God is truth, but at times this can be less than comforting. When we recognize this and begin to look at our lives through the lens of God's truth, we begin to see how far short we are abiding in his truth. We have talked recently, a couple of weeks ago, about trust and how when we sin, we are, in a sense, telling God that he is the liar and that what he has said is best is not actually best. And so we live in a tension. We see the truth, and yet we fall short of the truth. This often leads to internal condemnation. Yet we can have confidence in this. He is still reassuring us, reminding us that he is greater than our hearts. Even with our limited grasp of eternal truths in him, he knows everything. Nothing is a surprise to him, not even our doubting moments. We can have confidence that we are rooted in Christ, and he will not doubt or condemn us. One commentator says it like this: the proposition that God is greater than our heart grants us assurance that he has forgiven us through the atoning work of Christ. Church, God is gracious. And when we come to him in faith by grace, we can be assured that even when we condemn ourselves, Christ is justifying us. This is not to say that internal conviction is bad. On the contrary, the Spirit that abides in us does convict us of sin, which ought to lead to repentance. But we can repent from a place of assurance in the ongoing work of grace in us. We need not fear the convictions of our heart. The Lord is greater than our hearts and knows everything, inviting us to approach the throne of grace with confidence. So what else is God revealing about himself in this passage? Well, God is generous, 1 John 3:22a, and whatever we ask, we receive from him, though his generosity is not without loving boundaries. He continues in the second half of the verse, because we keep his commandments and do what pleases him. When our hearts and minds are aligned with God's, our prayers, requests, and petitions before him will ever so slowly be syncing up with his good, pleasing, and perfect will. He generously gives. That is a fact about God. But our understanding is limited when compared to God's, and he sees the true good for us and answers our prayers according to that, not according to our own interpretation of what is good. Does that make sense? There's an old Garth Brooks song, and I don't know if anybody had Garth Brooks on their sermon bingo card, but here goes. Garth sings, sometimes I thank God for unanswered prayers. Remember when you're talking to the man upstairs that just because he doesn't answer doesn't mean he don't care. Some of God's greatest gifts are unanswered prayers. Pretty good theology for Mr. Brooks. Just because God doesn't always answer in the way we would like does not mean that he is not generous. It just means that we haven't quite seen what God sees. He better knows than we do what we need. Does this mean we shouldn't pray? If God gives according to his wisdom and does not act as a divine vending machine, does this mean it is just useless to ask him for things? Well, I would contend no, not at all. Firstly, we're called to pray, and not just pray, but to pray unceasingly. Secondly, it is in this prayer that we're building a deep, holistic relationship with God. And thirdly, We are submitting to trust when we pray, recognizing that God is God and we are not. It is good to pray, and God is generous. Trust in what he gives you when you ask him for things according to his wisdom and generosity. Another element of God's generosity is him dwelling in us. 1 John 3:24b, and by this we know that he abides in us by the Spirit whom he has given us. The Spirit has been given, not taken. He is a gift. We see through the tragic mistake of Simon in the book of Acts that when he sees the apostles laying hands on believers and the Spirit being given to them, he wants this power and asks to buy it from the apostles. Well, he is soundly rebuked, but it is a reminder, the person of the Spirit is not purchased, but given by a generous God to his children whom he loves. What is an implication for us here? Well, we too are called to be generous. God loves a cheerful giver. We ought not live with a closed fist as though all that we have is our own, but we must recognize that all good things come from above. When we are stewards of the gifts of God, and we can reflect the character of God by being generous, both in giving of things and giving of ourselves. Now, the last element of God that we will look at in our passage today is that through the person and work of the Lord Jesus Christ, God is displaying his call to love. He has not asked from us anything he has not done or is willing to do himself. To love is to act, and to act is to love. We cannot separate these two. 1 John 3:23, and this is his commandment, that we believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another just as he commanded us. Our belief is made manifest in our actions. And this is a picture of God's love being made manifest in Emmanuel, God with us, and in loving us to the greatest extent by dying for us on the cross. We can begin to cultivate a deep relationship with God, knowing that he is eternally relational through the Trinity, and that he is revealing himself to us, for us, to enter into relationship with him. God reveals himself, and through understanding him more, we can begin to understand ourselves more. So what is God revealing about us through this passage? That's our second point. Now, these passages we've read point us to the nature of God towards us, but they also should act as a mirror in a way, meaning the scripture is pointing back at us, our true reflection. We will be looking over some of the same verses that we just looked at, but this time from the perspective of what they say about us. So what can we learn about ourselves? Well, firstly, we must recognize that our disposition as humans is so often to live in a place of earning. And because we instinctively know that we cannot attain perfection, we condemn ourselves. Again, for whenever our heart condemns us, verse 20b. This is not a possible outcome, it is guaranteed. And when we look to find our hope within, we will never find rest. There is always an element of condemnation when we are looking to ourselves for salvation and perfection. So this passage reveals that we must be conscious of our own condemnation, and we must step into assurance that is only found in the person and work of Jesus Christ. God is greater than our heart, and he knows everything. Don't make the mistake to believe that God isn't aware of your heart. Whatever you've done that is moving you towards feelings of self-condemnation, God has seen that too. Yet in Christ, he does not condemn us as our hearts do, but offers us assurance. So be thoughtful to your own heart. And don't always believe how you feel. Rest in the Word of God and what the Lord has revealed about who he is and who we are in light of that. For our hearts condemn, but God redeems. This just reminds us of our need for total surrender to God. Verse 23a, and this is his commandment, that we believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ. It is in Christ that our hope is found. We must rest in the truth of God, not in our own truths. Our hearts are cruel masters, but God is merciful and greater than our hearts. Now, why as parents do we often feel compelled to tell our kids to not do things like don't eat those cookies or don't stay out too late? Well, it's because we feel like if we don't tell them, they'll probably eat that cookie and they probably will stay out too late. It's similar to God's commands for us. He often gives them to us because our default is probably to do the opposite of what he's asking. For example, in verse 23b, it says, "And love one another, just as he commanded us." This reveals to us that our default posture is not godly, biblical love, and so we must be told and commanded to love. But praise God, because we are not just commanded to love, we are shown what love looks like. Again, by the person and work of Jesus Christ. We need to be called into, shown how, and commanded to love in the way God intended. Because left to our own devices, our pursuit is so often a deformed love, one that does not have the benefit of the other person in mind. To operate in the love that God has called us into is to allow the boundaries of God's word to guide us and to submit under his authority. Now, our effort, apart from God himself abiding in us through the Spirit, is lacking. If we were to seek to live the holy life God has called his people into on our own, we would and do ultimately fail. It is only in the hope of the presence of God, the Spirit in us, that we can find rest. Verse 24b, "And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit whom he has given us." We must surrender under the power of the Spirit. It is in the presence of God, the Spirit, that we do not cower in fear, but are given assurance of salvation. It is by the power of the Spirit that we can approach the throne of grace with confidence, knowing that through the blood of Jesus we are justified, and if so justified, we are assured of our salvation. Okay, so we've established that true knowledge of ourselves comes from being in deep relationships and community, and this is ultimately true within our relationship with God. When we find out more about the God we worship, we see ourselves more clearly. And when we see ourselves more clearly, we are more equipped to step into the life that God has for us. But this life was never meant to stop with us individually. Yes, we are meant to pursue a deeper relationship with the triune God. Yes, it is good for us to be established in the assurance of our faith. Yes, it is good for us to rest in the relationship we have with God through the love and blood of Jesus Christ. But it was never meant to stay there. Now remember, we are meant to love God, love our neighbors, and make disciples. If these truths we covered today do not spur us on to love and good works, to loving God, loving others, and making disciples, then I don't think we really are allowing the word to penetrate our hearts as it should. So what are some implications for us as we go back into the week, as we look down the barrel of Monday? Firstly, remember that God is greater. God is not only greater than our heart, but all hearts. The hope of the world is not found in us, but in the Trinitarian God of the Bible. In saying that God is greater, this passage is also saying the world is deficient. As God's people, the only message that we can preach that carries with it hope for the world is the surrendering of our hearts to the heart of God, who is generous, kind, loving, and he knows everything. There is no heartbreak, brokenness, or trial that God is not aware of, and nothing that he cannot relate to and empathize with through the advocacy of Jesus Christ. We see through this passage that the rule and reign of Jesus is made alive to the world through his people abiding in and obeying him. Verses 23 to 24. "And this is his commandment, that we believe in the name of his Son, Jesus Christ, and love one another, just as he commanded us. Whoever keeps his commandments abides in God, and God in him. And by this we know that he abides in us, by the Spirit whom he has given us. This reveals the both and nature of God's relationship with us. He has both called, equipped, and saved us apart from our works, and he has also called, equipped, and saved us to do good works. If we are to choose one or the other, the message we proclaim will be deficient, for it will not be the whole counsel of God. We are God's ambassadors. We are part of his rescue plan for the world. We are not the Savior, but we are image bearers of him, and we are to point to him in both word and deed to the glory of God. When we see, stay on there now.
Sorry, I'm not used to these concert mics.
I'm back. When we see that God is gracious, generous, loving, patient, communal, relational, we cannot forget that we are being called into the same pattern of life, and we can be witnesses to the grace of God by going and doing likewise to those around us, building up our neighbors. This often doesn't look like us just sharing the gospel and then leaving, but it looks like us entering into messy lives, tangibly loving and helping others, all the while we are speaking the gospel to them both in word and deed. Church, we cannot fully understand who we are apart from an understanding of who God is. Passages like these gives us a window into the nature of God, our own natures, and how through the love of God by the work of Jesus and the indwelling of the Spirit, God is calling us into a rightly ordered life in relationship with him. We cannot fully, truly live out the call that are in verses 16 to 18 unless we have rightly ordered ourselves, knowing God, knowing ourselves, and loving the world. Those verses read, "By this we know love, that he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brothers. But if anyone has the world's goods and sees his brother in need, yet closes his heart against him, how does God's love abide in him? Little children, let us not love in word or talk, but in deed and truth." We are not equipped to love fully until we have known, believed in, and submitted to God. God wants to have a relationship with you. God is relational, eternally so through the Trinity, and so he did not create us to fill a void, but out of an abundance. He has revealed himself to us through his word so that we can begin to rightly order our lives around him and his truth, not around ourselves and our truth. Remember what Calvin said at the beginning, "We always seem to ourselves just and upright and wise and holy until we are convinced by clear evidence of our injustice, vileness, folly, and impurity. Convinced, however, we are not if we look to ourselves only and not to the Lord also, he being the only standard by the application of which this conviction can be produced. We are deficient. Jesus makes us whole. Trust in the Lord Jesus for salvation. Rest in the truth of the gospel. Pursue knowing God more. See yourself as he sees you. Love God, love your neighbor, and make disciples." Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word, that it shows us who you are. Lord, we thank you that you've revealed yourself to us, that you are gracious in doing so, that every word of the scripture points us to you. It is a theological statement of who you are. And you are calling us, warning us, beckoning us to answer, receiving the call to come to you, all who are weary and heavy laden, and receive rest through Jesus Christ. I pray, Lord, as we open the scriptures this week, we would remember to look at it as we get to know you, that we would know ourselves more through you, and that we would use that to love the world, to love you, and to love our neighbors. We thank you for your grace and your mercies. And in Jesus' name we ask and pray all these things. Amen. All right, today is Communion Sunday. So as the
This gentleman will come up to help distribute the bread and the cup. So say a few words. When we use the law of God as our barometer of holiness, we cannot help but see that we are unholy. We have fallen far short of the standards of our righteous God. The Apostle Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 2, 1 through 3, "And you were dead in the trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is now at work in the sons of disobedience, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and were by nature children of wrath like the rest of mankind." When we are growing to know ourselves, we see that we have fallen far short. None of us can live up to the righteous requirements of the law. It can seem hopeless, like we are trying to dig a hole of holiness on the beach while the waves of sin are crashing around us every time we seem to get a shovelful, more sand washes in. So where does that lead us? Well, the Apostle Paul continues in his letter to the Ephesians. In the very next verse, he says, "But God, being rich in mercy, because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved." But God. Some of the two most powerful words together. But God, knowing us fully and being fully complete in himself, has shown us the richness of his mercy. By grace we have been saved. So as we approach the communion table today, we are going to do so in light of those words, but God. And as we have put our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, we can approach the throne of grace with confidence. And so as we distribute the bread and the cup, I encourage all to assess their relationship with the Lord. Remember that when we know God more, the more we know ourselves. And this ought to lead us into loving God more, loving others more, and making disciples as we go. So I encourage us all, repent of the sins that may be ensnaring you and rest in the grace of God and the grace of the new covenant in Christ. If you have not yet confessed that Jesus is Lord and submitted to him as King, we encourage you to let the bread and the cup pass. And if you would like to continue a conversation of what it is to be a recipient of the new covenant of grace, myself or one of the other elders up here would love to have that conversation with you. So I encourage each of us that we would pray in our hearts as the bread and the cup are distributed, as Dana plays music, that we would spend the time repenting and resting in the Lord God Almighty.
The Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Amen.
Please stand as we respond in praise with Jesus. Thank you.
Sacrifice, I've been brought near. Your enemy.
Join me for the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, now and forevermore. Go in peace to the glory of God. Amen.